Forget that I have given her an extra key.
Welcome to Lyons Den After Dark. Boy, I got some opinions on Gilly, too.
Gilly? Oh, yeah. Ooh. She got thick.
She looks
not in the good place.
She looks pregnant.
That's like my only note.
Yeah. She got thick in the jowls, not in the good places. Is she pregananant? I gotta get it out now. All right.
Hi, everyone, and welcome once again inside the Lyons Den. I'm your host, Bill Lyons, and you are listening to another episode of Real Rants. And I'm joined today by my guest, Dave Croy.
Hey, what's going on?
And Ryan Child, back again.
Howdy, howdy.
And today we're going to be talking about Game of Thrones Season 8, Episode 2, continuing our Game of Thrones series.
All right.
So I want to start this episode by addressing a couple things that we got wrong. One of them being that I was wrong that Gilly and Little Sam were at Hornhill.
I thought they were too, but surprised they're not.
We all thought they were. Like, I guess there was a scene where he took them up there from Hornhill. Had to have been.
Yeah, I remember them leaving, so.
Gilly's not looking that good these days.
All right, so when I saw the scene, first scene she was in, the first thought I had was, is she pregnant? She looks pregnant.
And is the character pregnant? I mean, like, she, like, the actress is probably pregnant, but is there going to be like, oh, by the way, Sam, I'm pregnant with your baby because we banged.
The first scene she was in, they tried to hide it real well. Like, well, I mean, in the face she looked it.
Jolly.
She was heavily dressed, so you couldn't really tell anything. But in a later scene, she was less heavily dressed, and it looked like she might be a bit preggers.
Well, I mean, we're talking about Samuel Tarly, killer of White Walkers and lover
of ladies.
That's right.
Sam the Slayer.
That's right.
I mean, and we all know the seed is strong, so.
I mean, if so, then why'd he give up that sword? You know what I mean? Heartsbane, that's a badass sword. I think it's the biggest sword, the biggest remaining sword.
Yeah.
It's a two-handed long sword. You know what I mean?
I mean, John's is pretty big.
Are we
comparing swords here?
Yeah, it's the ultimate.
Are you jealous?
Hey, masculine. Take a look at Heartsbane, dude. I mean, it's bigger than the Mormont sword. I guess Heartsbane is the Mormont sword now, since Jorah has it.
Yeah, it's a Mormont sword.
Yeah. Well, the other sword is the Stark sword now. The Mormont sword is now the Stark sword.
Oh, God. the sword chooses the wielder, dude.
Also, this is the game of swords. Have you noticed that? Like, all the swords just keep changing hands. They took that Stark sword and they
turned into
took that gigantic Scottish claymore that was the Stark sword and they turned it into two long swords.
Two Lannister swords.
Yeah. Widow's Wail and Oathkeeper?
Yes.
Is that what they were?
Okay. Which then one turned into Brienne's sword.
Right.
Which then
he gave the Oathkeeper to Brienne. Which is fitting.
So let's start with the trial to officially open the show. I thought a lot of great things happened in the scene. First thing I wanted to touch on, though, I wanted to ask you something specific, Dave.
Mm.
So you have been very adamant, especially with the season one roundtable, you've been very adamant that doesn't matter what Jaime does or how his character changes, you are always going to think biggest piece of shit, basically. Like, you're never going to turn that leaf with him.
No.
So to speak, like, did that change?
That's just personal. Nah.
That didn't change at all for you?
Nah, he's still a huge piece of shit.
Held true to that? Yeah. Okay, I was wondering, because I was watching, I was with the trial and the scenes with Bran.
I mean, he did a nice thing for Brienne. That was touching. But now you know Brienne's absolutely going to die, because she basically, like, as soon as she was knighted, you were like, oh, well, her character's done. That's it. That's her arc. Like, she's going to die brutally.
I read different in that. Like, I've been adamant since almost the beginning that Jaime kills Cersei in the end.
Mm-hmm.
This almost felt like a passing of the torch moment, and Jaime's going to die.
Well,
he is looking.
I think
rough.
They're both going to die, actually. I think Arya might, like, you'll see Jaime kill Cersei, and then Arya will take the face off. You know what I mean?
Okay.
I mean, I'm in.
Like, you won't see her take Jaime's face, but
you'll start to see something. That's like, real cool. That's
like, if her eye catches Jaime fall, like, that's a good face to have.
I mean, if Arya survives the zombie attack, it could just be, I'm going to harvest some faces and go wreck someone's shit. Who do I want to be today? I want to be the Night King today.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah, how much of the face is left on that guy?
Rigor mortis is set in.
A little sunken, but...
I mean, she's not taking dicks.
I mean, rigor mortis affects the entire body, but I know. Well, she...
We covered this last episode.
Also, we'll get to it. She is taking dicks.
Okay, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's true. She's taking dick.
Well, that's one of many, maybe.
She's taking a dick.
Yeah. She said it was her first, so...
Yeah.
Continue on with the trial. Daenerys seemed real alone in that, like, Sansa was almost with her, and then Brienne came in and, you know, vouched for Jaime. And basically, I want to ask you guys, if it was just, like, Daenerys and Tyrion, like, there's no Warden of the North, there's no Lady of Winterfell to kind of usurp her decision in any way.
Right.
Do you think Daenerys hesitates to execute Jaime?
Probably no. Even if Brienne stands up for Jaime without Sansa or Jon being there, I'm pretty sure he probably just gets executed.
Even with Tyrion like pleading for him as well?
If there's no Brienne, then absolutely he does.
Yeah.
It's just Daenerys versus Tyrion.
Right.
And then all the yes men will just yes.
Right.
Say yes to Daenerys and Jaime will die. Because it's an old grudge that...
Right.
Yeah, because it started that way. Like, she was so ready to just kill him. And Sansa kind of was starting to back her up. But Brienne was the linchpin. No, like, he's an honorable man.
Sure.
And then she even turns to her lover, Jon, like, what does the warden say? Like, right. Come on, help me out. Back me up against your sister and this big bitch.
That puts Jon in a huge, like... in a bad position because
but we all expected his answer like right. Nothing would have shook his answer. It doesn't matter what the circumstances are, that would have been his answer.
There was
a
huge pregnant pause, and I think he was trying to word it
so that it
or the actor was giving the perception of he was trying to word his answer in a
it would have been interesting in a good way. Had Jaime showed up after the zombie attack, if that threat was gone, would right. Jon have still said, we just need every person? He wouldn't have said that.
Because... No, probably not. I think even with the Brienne vouch, like, I think Jaime's still dead at that point.
All Jaime has to do is tell his story. Because he told it to Brienne that time when he was basically fevered out and dying. Because he got his hand cut off. Right. When I killed the Mad King because he was going to blow up the city. If he
she knows all that. Like, they've told her all that before.
Well, Brienne knows. I don't know if everyone else knows the full extent to it. Because, like, only Jaime was there to see it, and he's only ever told Brienne the story of him saving the city by killing the king, which gives him the Kingslayer name.
So, speaking of swords, one of the last things about that scene I want to touch on, because we talked about this in the first episode, we were kind of theorizing about what might happen with the sword, and literally nothing, but it's not what we thought. He was given the sword back. There was no, like, identity loss. There was kind of a purposefully done pause by the creators of the show when Grey Worm gave him his stuff back. I don't know what that is, but watching it a second time, I was just like, that's a real, like, purposeful moment there when he's given his sword back. And
they were fully expecting to just, like, execute him.
That's part of it. And also just the way they framed that shot, they put the hilt of it right on Front Street so you can see how, like, gilded it is and bejeweled and all that kind of stuff. I don't know. I feel like things aren't over yet with that sword.
This might not even relate, but it could have been the contrast between Grey Worm, who came up only knowing how to fight and being a slave guy, handing over the gilded, fancy, rich man-looking sword to the definition of excessive richness. And
right. And that's kind of an interesting segue. You know, he has that sword, but he tells Tyrion, you know, he's no longer, his golden lion days are far behind him. So I don't know if that even is something that suits him anymore. Because he all through the episode, he looks just beaten in every way, shape, and form.
Mm.
Well, he's had a rough time the past four or five seasons.
Also, he rode...
to King's Landing in a day, apparently.
He rode from King's Landing in a day and a half.
Yeah, he killed 56 horses on this trip.
So right after the trial, we move into a very important scene between Daenerys and Tyrion, where Daenerys is just very just like shitting on Tyrion pretty hardcore and threatening his title, threatening his Woo. His place in her court.
You got one job. Use your think.
Do you guys think her lashing out was founded, was well founded? Like, he's gotten her to the Seven Kingdoms.
He's also missed a few times. Like, the we're going to attack Casterly Rock and take it from my brother and all them, and it's just empty, and that let Highgarden get attacked.
Right.
We're going to sail our boats this way, and they just got ambushed.
Right.
Like, he's missed a few times. Like, more than hit.
But also, by asking Daenerys to trust Cersei, it's made her look like a fool as well, not just Tyrion.
And Tyrion also said you should trust Jon Snow, and we'll see how that pans out with all the drama going on between right. aunt and nephew.
Because he finally tells her at the end of the episode. And
yeah. Right, I mean, before the battle.
Yeah.
Right when the
poorest timing of all time.
Right.
I wonder how that's going to work out with the dragons. Because the dragons are not mentioned. I mean, they're mentioned, but they're not. You don't see them at all in this episode. Well, we haven't seen the dragons for a while,
actually. I guess we'll skip ahead. But at the end of the scene, when the dead are coming and the two walk away, John gives like the nod and they both walk away in the same direction. I believe it's implied they go to the dragons.
Do you think Daenerys's renewed faith in Tyrion by the end of the episode through Jorah, do you think it's something that she really believes in, or just she's trusting Jorah now? And then just because she kind of did that with Sansa as well, where it kind of felt disingenuous. She kind of went to talk to Sansa and you could tell the smile was fake, and you know, right. she really didn't believe what she was saying. To me anyway, that's how it looked like. But with Tyrion in the war council scene, she really shows concern, but I couldn't really peg if that concern was genuine or if it was just based on Jorah.
Just diplomatic.
I think it's also more convenient too, because Tyrion, even though he's been in battle, is not a fighter. So like, even if it's I don't like him much and he's been wrong a bunch of times, sending him out to fight is executing him. They almost to like give him one more shot.
I think Tyrion has put a lot of emphasis on his Blackwater quote unquote victory for all these years.
He fought in the Blackwater and in season one, when him and Catelyn got attacked on the way to the Vale, he killed someone with a shield. He's not the best, offensive person, but defensive he does pretty well. Attacking someone who doesn't expect him. Probably not great for zombies, because they probably don't think like that.
Greatest at crossbowing someone on the shitter of all time.
Yeah, I mean, he didn't miss. So. He's 2 for 2 with a crossbow.
Hell yeah, dude. Hitting someone point blank on the shitter with a crossbow, he's your dude.
Yeah, he's your guy with that axe.
I wonder if he'll get like a dragon glass axe. That'd be kind of cool. It'll be him and the little girl with the burn scar defending the crypt.
Well, she's going to have a giant dragon glass sword that she can barely carry.
Yeah.
But then, that'd be sweet.
Like, 3 people around her are going to get eaten. She's going to go like Super Saiyan and just murder everyone.
She's got like the cloud buster sword.
Yep.
Over her shoulder, dude.
It's bigger than the crypt, but we're going to make it work.
Oh, yeah. I'm down for that.
I want to talk about Arya and Gendry. Ryan perked
Already?
Up over
skip
here.
Ahead, skip ahead, skip ahead.
Oh, it's my ship.
Well, because they interact before that happened.
Right, that's true. She does get him to make that weapon.
Yeah, get my staff ready.
Yeah.
I thought it was really cool that she got to show off her skills, because he has not seen... Like you guys mentioned in the previous episode, he hasn't seen her since she was basically a little boy.
Right.
So seeing the finished product,
mm-hmm.
as
she
it
was
were.
Like, ooh, this dude is hot.
Literally, he's a smith, so he's
got bumps where people shouldn't have bumps.
But she gets to show off her skills with the arrowheads or whatever. He's just like, ooh, 6 to midnight. All right. I'll get right on it. Mm-hmm. You know?
Get right on it.
She's seen him in the blacksmithing, so it's right. It's only fair for him to see her do
she
her
ain't,
thing. She just hasn't killed anyone yet in front of him.
She ain't never seen him not sweat.
Well, what I love about it is not a lot of people know about Arya's skills, which is, I'm sure, how she wants it.
Right. I mean, she's an assassin. You're not supposed to have a bunch of people know what's happening.
Right.
So it's cool for them to have Arya show off her skills a little bit to civilian. However, skipping along, this was pretty jarring for me. I don't know how it was for you guys, but this was a very jarring change.
You weren't like, finally.
Well, yeah, part of me was like that.
Well, I mean, I was. I was like, finally.
Yeah.
You get it, Maisie. Do your thing.
Even though,
but it wasn't really her though. Everything below the neck.
All right, we're gonna have to watch this CGI again and slow it down.
It's interesting you guys bring it up though, because I recently saw an interview where Maisie was talking about the character throughout the seasons, and they purposely stunted her growth.
Yeah, made her smoke cigarettes, drink coffee.
Smoke weed, do drugs.
I mean, basically when she hit puberty and started growing boobs, like around 14 or 15, she said they started making her wear a strap to keep her breasts down.
Yeah, I read that interview too.
And then it got harder to do that, so they gave her thicker clothes to equalize it out.
Mm-hmm.
So they've literally kept her as a non-sexual thing for the whole show until this fucking episode, and that's why it's so jarring.
Sure, yeah.
For six seasons, she was a child, and the past two, she's been an adult.
She's out of nowhere an adult, yeah. Like, she was 12 a year ago.
Yeah. Not like there was a lot of time for her to just, like, explore her sexuality while she's crossing names off the list, but...
I don't think any of us are shocked about her forwardness with it, but she seemed to get a little extra excited after he told her that he was a Baratheon. Do you guys notice that?
Nah. Well, I mean, look, she's thinking like any other teenager would. I'm a virgin right now, and I could die before the sun comes up.
She's playing the teenage boy role.
I mean, girls are sexual beings too. Yeah. Girls like sex too.
I also think the whole Baratheon.
Really?
Yeah.
Fuck, they lied to me.
The whole Baratheon thing, I think it might have been more of a store for later. Like, oh, that's interesting, but I have one thing to do right now.
Get it in.
Also, like, it's a fun thing sort of paralleling the beginning of the season where it's Robert and Ned in the crypt. It's like, you have a daughter, I have a son. We'll pair them and do our thing. And now it's sort of happening.
Yeah, this is the true union between Stark and Baratheon.
Also, again, the seed is strong, so this could be dangerous.
Mm-hmm. Dark of hair.
You think he did it in one shot?
For Arya, I hope not, but...
Yeah, did you see her face afterwards?
We can talk about this, too.
She was like, I'm praying. She looked real sad.
I thought she looked satisfied.
Yeah? Is that what a satisfied girl looks like? Oh, boy.
I mean, two or three times that I know of, but...
I guess I gotta go look at the scene again. She looked like she conquered him. Like she got what she wanted.
She looked like she smelled a fart.
It looked to me, and I'm gonna get serious for a minute. It looked like she was disappointed,
right?
But not because of what happened. She wasn't disappointed in Gendry. I think she was disappointed because she feels alone. Like she couldn't connect to somebody.
Going back to Dave's point from the previous episode, like she's not anchored anywhere.
Right. Like it's she tried to have a connection to someone, and
she tried to force it,
and she feels like it didn't work, so she is by herself again.
That's gonna be real disappointing.
I mean, as she's always been.
That makes a lot of sense. That'd be real heartbreaking if that was the thing, because it's a person that I think she really enjoys and really cares about, and someone from her past. So it's not like it's some random new person. Like she does have a connection with this guy, and she took it to the next level. And if it didn't, if it ended up not meaning anything to her, that could
that it didn't mean anything to her, just that she thought she would feel different afterwards.
You think maybe she wants to break the whole assassin-y thing?
I think she wanted to feel normal,
right?
But It's also it's a person from her past, and I don't know if she can hold on to her past anymore. That could be real in the weeds we have four episodes left, and I don't know if we can explain that in four episodes.
We all kind of thought that the shit was going to hit the fan this episode, which, again, I'm not complaining at all. I loved kind of the last knight motif they had going on.
Sure,
Another, another character-driven episode before it's just all zombie fights.
Right.
Great writing in this episode.
I loved it.
It's the funniest fucking episode of Game of Thrones, dude.
the humor is great. Moving into that, Bran's a dick. He went from Brannigan to like this cheeky little fucker in a wheelchair.
But he's entitled though.
No, yeah, super entitled. But yeah. at the trial, he goes
hits him with the things we do for love. That's right.
And in the Godswood, he goes, "Well, who says there's gonna be a later?"
Yeah.
For you, or whatever it was that he says. And and Jamie's just like, oh, fuck.
Who says there's going to be an afterwards?
Yeah, that's it.
I mean, it's real hitting you over the head with it, but also can lend credence to...
This was also a pretty...
A Jamie dies in the next episode sort of thing.
But he might just be fucking with Jamie, too, at the same time.
I mean, he's a tree wizard that is paralyzed because of him.
I mean, he just suggested to Jamie that, like, you're going to die. And you would still be that piece of shit had you not done it. That's what he said. There was no sign of the Brannigan in this episode.
He says something else that's kind of interesting, because they don't interact a ton, which was a little disappointing. But he says, you still would be if you hadn't pushed me out that window. And,
right.
I would still be Brandon Stark. So what does the end game look like to you guys if the push out the window hadn't, if Bran had never climbed up that tower?
Zombies win, because we don't know they're coming. I mean, we find out at the wall a few times, but we don't know the extent of it.
Right. So the north probably gets taken right away. They might be able to flee south and maybe like rally the troops in King's Landing.
The bad guys wouldn't get a dragon.
Jon Snow and the wildlings knew about them, right?
Yeah, but forever, no one trusted the wildlings.
Yeah, and they weren't listening to John either.
Right, and John would just be dead. It's all fated to happen this way.
Continuing with the humor, again, Tyrion and Jaime have this really great rapport and great humor together. But what I found interesting was, like, the forgiveness was instant. Like, as soon as the trial was over, and as soon as they saw each other in the courtyard, there was no more, like, you killed my father hatred. There was no more.
Oh, no. That's all water under the bridge. Like, so much shit's happened since then. And it's not like Tywin was innocent. Right. You know right. what I mean?
Right. Like, I think Jaime had disdain for his father, but the last time they saw each other, that's all they could really say to each other was Jaime's disdain for Tyrion because of the act. So I liked that. There was none of that. Like, the scene wasn't bogged down with any of that. It was just immediately back into their old relationship. Tyrion's death speech of dying at 80. That was...
Right. What the girl's mouth on my cock.
Also, the if I die, I hope I get back to King's Landing and strangle Cersei.
Right, right.
That was fun.
Yeah. I also think there's a moment in the courtyard before they hit the wall. I feel like there's a small part in there where Jaime is fishing for reassurance from Tyrion. Jaime has made the choice to leave Cersei, right? And he's asking Tyrion about Daenerys. Like, are you sure? Are you sure?
She's different, right?
Yeah. I think he's looking for validation through Tyrion.
That he made the right choice?
That he made the right choice, exactly.
I mean, Tyrion gives it to himself. True. He's like, yeah, she's different. She's definitely different.
But really, I don't think she is. I think that Targaryen rage is just like in her DNA. It's going to be her downfall.
That's what she needs Tyrion for. Tyrion sort of calms it.
But Tyrion won't be there. He'll be in the crypt.
Well, if it's fighting zombies, we need the Targaryen rage.
I do not think Jaime has a true capacity to show love anymore. Obviously, he has the hots for Brienne, and he morphs his feelings for her into service.
I don't think he is or has ever been in love with Brienne. He respects her, and he admires her for having her moral compass, but I don't think that he is in love with her. He may love her like as like a friend or something
he loves her like a sister.
Like a sister.
I actually wholly disagree with what Bill said. See, I think he actually is showing a capacity. Like, I think he didn't have the capacity of love while he was with Cersei.
Right.
But now he is showing that he can. I believe he's reforming himself. Like, he's on the redemption tour. You know, forgiving forgiving Tyrion for killing his father and acting like it didn't happen. Showing his affection, however it may be, for Brienne. Being cordial with the wildling later.
I can't believe he had the balls to apologize to Bran, dude.
Yeah, and apologizing to Bran, which he wouldn't have done.
Yeah, he wouldn't have cared.
In his Prince Charming role. Well, and actually just being tried in general, just in front of the people. Just whatever you say, that's what's going to happen. Like, I'm going to defend myself, clearly. Like, by speaking, but if it's execution, then that I deserve it.
Well, hopefully in the last four episodes, we get some kind of answer to that, because I would like to see one way or the other where his arc ends and it not just be cut short because he's cut down. So let's talk about the scene with Sansa and Dany.
Okay. Yeah.
A lot's going on in that scene, a lot of undercurrent stuff.
Yep, a lot of fakeness going on there,
which was going to be my absolute first question. I asked it a little bit earlier, but the sincerity,
I think Daenerys sincerely tries to connect with Sansa, but it's merely for political gain. Like, she wants Sansa on her side, obviously. She basically just wants the North to fall in line, but Sansa wants to be independent.
And to Sansa's credit, she is very unbreakable.
Right. Her tone very much changed with the what about the North lines.
Yes, I want to talk about that.
Yeah, I think Daenerys started off sincere, like in the first couple minutes, right, and then realized Sansa wasn't someone she could just talk to and get her to change her mind.
Right.
And then just sort of went through the motions towards the end of it.
Do you see any kind of interpretation with the what about the North line that, like, okay, if we beat the Army of the Dead and you don't declare the North free, you're gonna fight us next?
I don't know if that was like a stance like that, but like, I think she was trying to say like that the North deserves to be free and that Daenerys should just yield.
Well, we all know that's not gonna happen,
right?
And neither will Sansa. So it kind of comes down to Jon, which,
hey, the North has Lyanna Mormont, so I'm not trying to fight that. Also, is Lyanna Mormont named after Lyanna Stark?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, because Sansa was like, you're named after my aunt, who, and you're just as beautiful. And she's like, I'm not beautiful, I'm a fighter.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. There's a line of dialogue in the Sansa-Dany scene that I feel like has a lot of foreshadowing with it. They talk about their families being complicated. Obviously, that can be immediately drawn, the Jon and Daenerys relationship, and everything else that's been really fucked up with both their families. But I kind of saw a little bit further, and maybe, if not offspring between Jon and Daenerys, some kind of cohesion where everything they have in common with their families being screwed up is what brings them together, hopefully, or tears them apart.
Right. Well, I mean, it's very much a draw the line to Jon and how he affects both families.
Right.
And about the North thing, the easiest way to fix this is for Jon and Daenerys to get married.
Absolutely.
And then just that sort of fixes everything. But then it's who rules what, and then you just be, the North can be its own thing, but you're married to the Queen of the South. The King of the North is married to the Queen of the South.
I'd go for that.
And it's, they're all connected.
Right. Well, I mean, Daenerys does say, you know, admits to Sansa that she loves Jon and she's there because of him, and she asks who manipulated whom. And I hope that was sincere. It seemed it. But yeah, that whole scene is very landminey.
Yeah, the end sounded very sincere when it was talking about men manipulating women, then, or women manipulating men because of love, and then her subverting it a bit. And then, but then we didn't actually get to hear the end of it, because, like everything else in this episode, it got interrupted.
Right, which is going to be the last thing I asked about the scene. Where do you guys think it goes if they're not interrupted? Because Sansa had her ice wall up. Daenerys is about to spit some fire. So where do you think that was going to go?
I think Daenerys was actually just going to table it.
You think?
Yeah, I think she was just going to be like, well, we'll talk about it after.
And Sansa could have also brought up that, like, Daenerys loves Jon, but since Jon brought back a Targaryen queen, he gave up his crown, so Jon doesn't have any say in the North anymore.
Well, I mean, apparently they made him warden of the North.
According to her, not the Northmen. The Dragon Queen appointed someone warden in the North.
Which, yes, I agree the North haven't completely come back to put their faith in Jon Snow yet. But that's how Ned was appointed. He was appointed by the king as a warden.
Well, that went back hundreds and hundreds of years to all the Starks. Most of the Starks were appointed warden of the North.
It has to start somewhere, Ryan.
Yeah, there were kings in the North, and the last one stood a king and knelt a lord, so.
It's exactly England and Scotland.
Yeah.
Mary, Queen of Scots. Mary, Queen of Scots was the monarch of Scotland, and then she was usurped by Elizabeth I. She unified the North and South.
Also, the North remembers. So if something bad happens during the zombie attack, the North will remember.
Unless they're all zombies.
The North will always fight for their independence. The North will
remember then, because we're all zombies.
Well, if Bran dies, no one's going to remember a fucking thing.
It's one of two ways with Bran. Either he can't die or he has to die.
So the next scene that happens is actually acutely emotional. I've watched it twice and it's got me both times. And that's when Theon pops back again, like Dave called it, just, you know, hyperdrive is apparently on ships from Westeros because they made it.
The wind's really picked up.
He has to go literally around the continent.
Yeah. The wind's really picked up.
Or he rode 15 horses into the ground.
Sailed from King's Landing to Winterfell somehow.
Took a boat from King's Landing. Took one of his sister's three boats from King's Landing to Winterfell. Or dropped off his sister at the Iron Islands, which is on the other side of the continent. There's no Panama Canal to get through. You have to go all the way around, which should have taken years. But nope, 3 days. We're good.
But, you know, I thought the emotion was great between him and Sansa.
Well, you got to remember, he saved her life.
The North remembers.
Which is basically my whole point, that I loved that her forgiveness, again, talking about the forgiveness being real, that her forgiveness for Theon was real. Because the last time we saw these two, Theon
saved her life.
Saved her life, and they parted ways in the woods.
Mm-hmm.
And you liked to see that, and when he talked with Jon at where were they?
Dragonstone,
right? That's the Baratheon,
the Targaryen place,
the Targaryen
where Daenerys sat on her throne.
Yeah, but that's where Stannis was, yes. Right? You know, Jon's very like brush off of him. He's just kind of like, you saved Sansa, that's why you're alive. So it's good to see that immediately. Her kind of, I don't want to say facade, because it's not a facade, but her hard exterior just melts away, and she's like, oh my god, you're alive and you're here.
Right.
I'm so glad you're here.
Well, it's also becoming the full redemption of Theon. We didn't see him interact with Bran yet, but it's...
Well, we did.
We did?
Yeah, in the War Council.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Okay. To follow what you were talking about with Jon, at the end of that season, last season, 7, Theon's there with Jon. It's like, I have to go get my sister. Like, and I'm battling between being a Greyjoy and a Stark, and they go on and on about that. But Jon says, like, I can't forgive you for everything, but what I can forgive you for, I do. Coupling that with the scene with Sansa and her basically breaking down and forgiving Theon, it's covering the stuff that Jon couldn't forgive.
Right.
Sansa's forgiving the rest of it, and Bran is forgiving the rest of it with Theon defending him. It feels the full redemption of Theon. So guess who's going to die next episode?
Well, the full redemption.
Yeah, not the full.
He can never be fully redeemed because he ate it.
He paid the iron price.
He paid the iron price.
Why do you guys think Sansa is so attached to him in this episode? Because we see them when they're doing that small montage towards the end of the episode where they're showing like everyone what they're doing, the very last bit.
And Theon and her are sharing a bowl of that.
Of like the gruel or whatever.
Bowl of brown, as they call it, flea bottom.
It's just hot onion water made by the onion chef.
Well, you stick with what you know.
Everyone in the line was like, there's no bread here. It's just cut up onion. He's like, onion chef.
That's Sir Onion. That's Sir Onion Chef to you. I think the Sansa Theon thing, he saved her. And even when Ramsay was in the castle, like, Theon was trying to help the entire time. Even if, like, it didn't seem like it, he was trying to be supportive and helpful.
You gotta go watch those episodes where she was in dire straits.
I feel like that might be the connection. Like they're two war vets that survived
Ramsay. Something very traumatic.
Yeah.
And the last scene where they're sharing the bowl of onion milk.
Onion slop.
Onion gruel. Almost felt like to Theon, like, this is what you could have had. Like, you could have been with Sansa and been happy. You sacked the city and paid the iron price, and now you're cannon fodder.
I have a lot of trouble believing that Sansa would be with Theon had none of that stuff happened to her. She was a little with the upturned nose, you know what I mean?
Well, so magical Christmas land for a minute. If Sansa hadn't gone south with Joffrey, she just stayed in Winterfell.
Mm-hmm.
Theon's a lord. If his dad dies, he's the lord of the Iron Islands.
Sure. I mean, technically, she only knows him as the ward of Ned Stark, prisoner.
Knows him as basically like a stepbrother. He's been there his entire life. Could have worked. But, I mean, there's no scenario where I want that to happen, except now.
Well,
except now I don't really want it because it doesn't lead to anything.
Right. There's no heir.
maybe Yara comes back and gets a hold of Sansa. Sansa's had it with men.
I mean,
oh no.
I mean the ship is Yara and Daenerys, so no, Yara's gotta just rule from the Iron Islands from now on. I think her arc's done. Unless she fights Euron at some point.
She's gonna die on the Iron Islands. The dragon's gonna fly over there and burn it down. It's just a couple of houses on some rock stilts.
It's also like 3 dragon wing beats away, apparently. It's not far from here.
No. She's like, the White Walkers can't get here.
I keep forgetting they have a fucking dragon.
Everyone in King's Landing, they don't even consider it a possibility that there's a dragon zombie.
Theory at the end of this episode about certain things that we didn't see in this episode.
Cersei. Where was she?
It involves Cersei, sort of.
Cersei or Euron?
We actually did not leave Winterfell, which was kind of weird that they called the first episode Winterfell and not this one. Did you guys care at all that we didn't leave Winterfell? I mean, I didn't. I was so enthralled with the writing.
Also, every dickless person on the show was in Winterfell.
That is true.
Every
all that matter. Yes.
Yeah. The entire Unsullied army.
the Unsullied army.
The most dickless people in the world were congregated in one stronghold.
The most people who paid the iron price are in one spot.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's the Unsullied army plus Theon plus Varys.
Right. Who didn't say a fucking thing all episode.
Varys is useless at this point.
Right.
Like, he is just there to get a check.
Right.
Yeah, he's a spy master. There's nothing to spy on.
Right. With what spies?
Right. Yeah.
He's just a bald dude with no paid the iron price.
Yeah. Also, I could not care less about Grey Worm and what's her face. If they had zero lines and the camera just panned to him once or twice, that'd be enough.
Which it almost was. That's almost all it was. And then
they had a long-winded dialogue about, like, do you want to grow old here? Like,
right. I hated that scene because it cracks the whole visage of what the Unsullied are.
Right.
Like, yeah, he talks about being true to his queen, but only until her enemies are gone. Like, what the fuck is that?
Well, how Unsullied is he now?
Well, actually, this is Daenerys. She put that idea in his head. She basically said, you all are free.
Well, yeah.
But you can follow me if you want. Like,
I don't know.
Try to survive this, and then once that's done, like, he's like, I'm gonna retire.
Also, it's a fun thing to envision going back to her island that they're peaceful and, you know, don't fight, and here comes this Unsullied army,
right,
led by a former person who lived here. Guess what looks like an invasion to me? This 8,000 warriors landing on your shores of a peaceful place.
I don't think Daenerys would stop Missandei. Grey Worm and Missandei from leaving, right?
Or even the rest of the Unsullied.
Yeah.
Then how does she promise their freedom.
Yeah.
How does she defend her crown if she loses her army?
Well, she said once her enemies are defeated, so I imagine Grey Worm is insinuating that once she takes King's Landing, once she takes the throne, isn't that what he said?
Yeah, basically. But then what does that leave Daenerys with? A couple dragons if they live, and...
What, the city guard?
And two Dothraki?
Yeah, the Dothraki horde, we call them.
Yeah.
Whichever one survives is the horse that mounts... the stallion that mounts the world or whatever.
There's not much to talk about with the war council scene. It's a pretty straightforward thing that happens. There's not a lot of undercurrent, but what I really found interesting about it was... If you take a look at that scene, especially the wide shots, it really kind of encapsulates how everyone is working together. Like, you literally have almost every important character in the series, in that room. I just thought it was really cool. Like, oh man, this is how far we've come from season one, episode one, all through all the wars, to... We're all banded together, and in a way, in that room, the realm is united.
Right. I mean, they're united against just an imminent threat to everything, common enemy.
Finally, everyone in one place after 7 seasons of waiting and getting everyone into position.
Actors that had never seen each other.
That's got to be...
That were on the show for a decade.
Right. That's pretty cool when the actors talk about that. Like, I've never worked with Daenerys, so I was so starstruck to see Emilia, you know?
Yeah.
She was basically just her and Jorah the whole time.
I felt a little snubbed that we didn't get more Tyrion and Bran. I kind of wanted to...
How much more could there be?
I kind of wanted...
Bran to push him out a window?
Tyrion, not Jaime.
Oh. Wrong Lannister.
Oh, my bad.
I wanted to hear more of that conversation.
Yep, you wanted to know what he got told.
Yeah.
It's basically just go watch Game of Thrones the past season. He's like, tell me about your journey to get here. And like, if there was any information he would have given, which I alluded to last podcast, someone go fucking talk to him because he knows everything. Tyrion is finally like, hey, tell me everything.
He's keeping it close to the chest, though. I don't think he's telling anybody.
Are we at the knighting scene yet? One of the best scenes in Game of Thrones history?
Wait. We got to talk about the Hound and Arya on top of the wall.
So
about not giving a shit about anything in the world together?
Oh, man. And their two interactions thus far in the first two episodes were just gold. In the first episode where she's just like, he's like, you left me for dead or whatever. And she's like, but I robbed you first.
Yep.
And then this episode.
I'm not spending my last night with you two miserable old shits.
Yeah.
She put up the defensive facade. The Hound tried to be actually, like, heartfelt.
Well, in his own way.
Is there anyone in this world you fought for other than yourself? He's like, I fought for you.
Didn't I?
That translates to, like, almost the I love you as, like, a child sort of thing.
Right.
I tried to defend you. I tried to care for you.
Right.
I did like the Hound's side of that. Although, I'm glad Arya, that's not where she ended up. We all know where she ended up. But even if the love scene didn't happen, I don't think that was her place.
Right.
You know?
Well, if it had just been the Hound,
I think
it could have been her place. But when Beric shows up, it's...
You gotta understand, like, the Hound had, like... the roughest childhood you could have. And so the fact that in his line that, like, I fought for you, didn't I? That was basically saying, like, that's more than anyone ever did for me.
Right. Beric the shithead. Ruining everything.
Oh, man. When he threatens to throw him over the wall, dude.
If only he
had... better not be given a serpent.
if only he had a chicken.
I mean, my only thing is I don't want Arya to kill the Hound unless he's dying already.
Like a mercy killing?
Yes. Like if she's giving the gift of death.
Right.
Like if he's like alive and doing okay and she just comes and kills him. Like that.
I don't think... She already crossed his name off the list, by the way.
The Hound is wounded and dying. Even if it's like a zombie bite, like dragon glass him to mercy kill him, to give him the gift of death. Like finally after all these years.
I guess it's going to depend on where everybody is, because it's still kind of unclear to me like where all the individual characters are going to be beyond Jaime being with Brienne.
Do you think the Hound is going to like kill Gregor the Mountain?
I hope so, because we get Clegane Bowl then.
But he's like mortally wounded. And then Arya, like...
Mercy kills him?
Mercy kills him.
Anything that has to do with down south is just a huge question mark for me right now because of the limited time that we have. Unless the entire battle happens in one episode, which, I mean, is entirely possible.
I'm going to give you another big question mark
and then
the
they all, and then they all ride to King's Landing in an afternoon.
In an hour and a half.
They take a day trip to King's Landing. Jamie went faster than the ships. Fuck.
He got there like a day after the ships did, and they got it. The ships had a head start. Okay, next topic. Sorry, I went on a rant about the Hound.
So we got to talk about Tormund, man.
Yeah,
good
that's
God.
It's one of the best scenes in
Holy
Game of Thrones history.
Shit, the funniest fucking thing that's happened on the show. Every fucking thing he did.
The hardest flex I've ever seen.
He is such a bro.
The way he just dragged the chair over, like one leg, and it was wobbling.
Like, I'm surprised,
one leg scraping the floor.
I'm surprised the walls didn't blow out with how hard he flexed.
Oh my God. And then he just like chugs the entire horn in everybody's face. He delivers giant's milk. Like, that's how I got so strong. Giant's milk. And then chugs the entire horn of whatever is in there.
Did you see Jamie's reaction? He just kind of looks over at Tyrion like...
Dude, Davos's reaction. I thought he almost broke and just started laughing. He's like, I got to get a fucking drink.
Did you guys see the behind the scenes when... The behind the scenes thing where he's chugging the whole thing and like after he's done there, like, cut and everyone just like falls out of their chair.
No, that's hilarious. Holy shit.
But yeah, what's the first thing he says after, you know, he bros out with John when he gets back? Is the big woman here?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I mean,
is the big woman,
man,
still here?
Yeah, priorities.
That's right, dude. They call you the king killer.
Yeah, the king. I'm sure someone does. Yeah, I guess.
They call me
Giant Spin. You want to know why? sitting right next to Brienne.
He like gives her some looks while he's like explaining it too.
Oh yeah.
He's fantastic.
Man.
He always has been. He's been gold since he started.
I was like laughing so hard.
In the council scene when he's like, well, we may all die, but at least we die together. Like that everyone smile just, he gives her, dude. Like, oh my God, this guy's got game. Why is she not just like giving it up?
Everybody was so quiet. Nobody was like consoled by that fact that they'd be dying together. They're like, all right, well, let's get out of here.
Time to get some rest, I guess. Thanks, Tormund, for making it awkward.
She's the Meg of the show. Tormund is the Meg.
I hope it ends up them having giant babies.
Did you guys have any takeaways from that scene? The gathering scene of everyone? The drinking scene?
Oh, man, that's what... Oh, the...
Just the drinking or the entire...
One of the best parts was
the whole scene.
Was when Podrick asked for a drink and Brienne's like, yeah, half dude. Cup. And Tyrion's just like...
He's pouring it on the floor.
Yeah.
That face.
Hooks
that,
up his brother.
Here's the whole picture.
Yep.
Yeah, that face he gives Podrick is just... Mm-hmm. You see like their entire relationship in that look of like, I got you, bro.
Yep.
It's also good to see Tyrion and Podrick actually together and not just like formally like standing next to each other. Like they get to hang out.
We almost got the scene that we wanted. We almost got the him, Bronn, and Podrick scene.
I mean, Bronn's on the way.
Right.
Maybe. Maybe.
If
we'll
they all
see.
Survive, Bronn's on the way.
Yeah.
With a sweet crossbow.
Yeah.
Podrick has
with
really...
With blue balls too, by the way.
Right. Sure, I'll stop having sex.
Yeah. I'll just tuck it in and leave.
I guess I'll pull out of this woman.
Yeah.
Oh, I'll get right on that for you.
Yeah.
Podrick has really grown.
I mean, one night with a prostitute. Now he's all cocksure.
With multiple prostitutes.
Yeah.
Like, you saw him training. He was actually training someone else. And
yeah, right. And he was...
Showing him up,
yeah,
too.
He was running the thing.
Yeah.
Well, he had a good teacher.
So that's that gives me hope that maybe he won't die.
He's the Mary Sue of the show, so he can't die.
Right.
Like, it's the author character. He can't die.
He can't die without revealing his secrets. We have to know his secrets.
We caught one of his secrets later in the scene. Did you hear him singing?
Yeah, he's the songbird of their generation.
The drinking scene where it's, I mean, even leading into the nighting, it's like Sir Davos of the Black, like, then Sir Jaime of whatever, then Sir Brienne. Oh, it's just Brienne. Why aren't you a knight? Because you're, because I'm a woman.
If
why
I
does
was
that
a
matter?
King, I'd knight you ten times over.
Yeah. Fuck tradition. And the, also, knighting 10 times over is like, we're just gonna fuck all night.
That was.
And then, did you not hear my giant's milk story?
The knighting scene, which is one of the best in the entire series.
I know. Like that was the first like toothy grin she gave. Like
yeah,
tears
smile,
in her eyes.
That smile was weird.
I mean, she was feeling pride. She was feeling everything. Like that was her secret dream. Not only was she on her knees in front of Jaime, but she was also becoming a knight.
Well, she was on her knees in front of Jaime. Yeah. She was on her knees in front of Jaime, and they were the same height. Finally,
yeah.
Oh wow.
Right.
Well, and then
they did pull it off because when it started, like when that part of the scene started, the knighting, I was like, oh man, this is going to be real cheesy and just a fast forward fodder. But it was actually very watchable, and it was simple. It was quick and emotional.
What were the three lines in the name of what? It was something, the father, then the mother.
Yeah. We're going to look it up.
Kneel. And then he holds the sword out like a cop, dude. You see that?
Yeah. Okay, so the oath goes. God damn it, Dave. So the oath goes in honor of the warrior.
God damn it.
You done?
Just swallow it.
Okay. So it's warrior brave, you know, father just and mother protect the innocent. After she's knighted and she rises, she gives the smile, which you guys are right. She just has so many emotions at once that I don't think she knows how to articulate that smile. But Tormund's reaction is the best thing about that scene.
The biggest clap.
He's like a proud parent of the toddler at a ballet or something. He's just like front clapping so huge, big goofy smile. He's like, I'm going to fuck that knight.
See, what I wanted in that scene, I think that scene is perfect how it is. All I wanted at the end of that scene, no Tormund clapping, but everyone else clapping. And Tormund at the end of the scene, just, okay, now do me.
Me next.
I want to be Sir Tormund. Me next.
That would have been great.
Which also, if they both live now, Brienne could knight Tormund because she's a knight.
However, the tears, like, her wish finally coming true, I think, is just a telltale sign that she's gonna die.
Yeah, it's like her story arc has ended.
Yeah,
and now her watch has ended.
It would also fit with the storytelling mechanism of, like, if Podrick lives, you know, her teachings, like the master dies for the young student to carry on.
Well, it also means Podrick can now officially be a squire again instead of just being an assistant, because he's with a knight. And also, if they both live, Podrick could be knighted and be Sir Podrick Payne.
Ooh.
And like that would basically conclude his story arc too. Because he's gone from nothing to...
I'm sure he'll be like a Kingsguard at the end of this.
Oh, yeah.
Can you imagine them like marching on King's Landing, like Podrick as a knight?
Lance and everything?
Mm-hmm. His station completely changed, like...
Okay, so Brienne dies in the zombie attack. Sir Podrick Payne is marching in Brienne's armor. Just, it's completely oversized. But it's like, I'm a knight, let's do it. Wielding Oathkeeper.
I was going to say, do you think he gets Oathkeeper?
Commander of the Targaryen armies, Podrick.
Sir Payne.
Sir Podrick Payne.
Right. He shows up to Cersei and he's just like, you've entered the House of Pain.
Ooh, here comes the pain train. Choo-choo.
My dad cut off Ned Stark's head. I'm here to cut off yours.
Wait a minute. I never knew that. I never made that connection that Illyn Payne was Podrick Payne's father. Yep. Wow.
Yep. Blew your mind. I did it.
Wow.
You didn't know that?
No, I never made that connection.
You know
never.
You know why Illyn Payne's not in the show anymore?
Arya killed him, didn't he?
No. She killed Meryn Trant.
Oh.
The actor died.
Oh.
So he's not in the show anymore. They casually wrote him off.
Mm-hmm. They never resolved it.
Yeah, he cut off.
He's still somewhere.
He cut off Ned's head and was done.
Mm-hmm.
they never blatantly make that connection, at least that I saw, ever.
A minor character being related to another minor character. Meh.
Well, at the time, minor, yes. Yeah. But, I mean, you'd think...
They also don't call him Podrick Payne much anymore. They just call him Pod.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but you'd think there'd be some kind of line of dialogue, like when he was serving Tyrion, of like, by the way, his father cut off Ned's head, executed Ned Stark.
Some little sly insert.
Yeah, like something. Maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm literally the only Game of Thrones fan that didn't make that connection. Wow, that's...
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, moving on.
So lore time. And it's not even like deep lore. It's just fun connections. When they knight Brienne, she arises Sir Brienne, a Knight of the Seven Kingdoms, which ties into a fun sort of lore book called A Knight of the Seven Kingdoms. The story of Duncan Egg, I don't know if anyone out there's read it, is about Aegon the Fifth and his friend Duncan the Tall, like a knight advising an heir to the throne. Aegon the Fifth becomes king after a bunch of people don't want to be... He's called Aegon the Unlikely because he's like the fourth son. One of his brothers marries a girl named Jenny of Old Stones, which is the name of the song Podrick is singing. And that song, I don't know if it connects the show, is about Aegon's brother who marries Jenny. It's Aegon's son that marries Jenny. Aegon said, if you marry Jenny, you can't be king, because he was the firstborn. He said, that's fine, I don't want to be king. His name was Duncan. Then Duncan and Aegon are at a place, Summerhall. There's a wedding there, and one of the Targaryens wants a dragon so bad he has petrified dragon eggs and wildfire and decides, I'm going to blow him up and have dragons again. So he blows up Summerhall and kills everyone. The song talks about Jenny dancing with ghosts. It is because Jenny is either there or close to, is at the place that exploded, or close to it, and it's talking about Jenny dancing with the people that died. Summerhall is also where Rhaegar Targaryen was born. So it's a fun little like connection, but I don't know if it's important. Mm-hmm. But it's
no,
like,
it's just fun to
like,
think
it's,
about.
It's like... the books haven't caught up to the show, but it's like, hey, we're still, here's a payoff for reading.
Well, yeah, and the showrunners did mention that while it's an original song, it is based in the books.
Yeah, it's sung, it's not exactly the same, the books, the show, but like I recognize the song pretty quickly.
That's cool. One of my favorite scenes beyond that, because I think that was probably one of my favorites, period, of the series. But one of my favorites of this episode was the Night's Watch reunion.
Sure, yeah, when they come back from Last Hearth.
You know, it's night, they're on the wall together.
Talking about how far they've come.
Yeah, and I almost wanted the episode to end there, because it's kind of the crisis started with them on the wall, and it's going to end with them on the wall. I really kind of liked that sentiment about it. I'm not mad about where the episode went from there, but I think that would have been a really cool logical closure point for the episode.
Right. It's also like they do mention where the three left, because they mentioned Pip and Gren.
Right.
They're the last of their group. But they also like poke fun at Ed, the Night's Watch leader now.
Right.
The one that is a tertiary character as opposed to a main character.
Right.
Because like Samwell Tarly's leading the fight, then we're actually fucked. And Sam is like, well, for you, I don't know if fuck's the right word. Which, like, I don't know if Sam should be mentioned that, because he's still technically Night's Watch.
Right.
Like, he got sent to Old Town to be the maester of the Night's Watch, and he's like, yeah, I banged all the bitches.
Right, yeah.
Lover of ladies.
Like, you're actually still speaking to the Lord Commander right now.
And, like, you're telling him you broke your oath.
It does beg the question of, you know, let's assume that good wins and everything's settled. Like what becomes of the Night Watch? Like... There's a whole portion of I guess the wall's wouldn't really be needed at that point. Is the Night Watch needed with White Walkers gone, wildlings integrated into the society?
The White Walkers never really go away. Because, like, last time it was, we beat them back to the other side of the wall,
mm-hmm.
and then they were gone for a while.
Build the wall and make the White Walkers pay for it.
That's right.
It's a shame the wildlings are on the other side, because you're supposed to be make the wildlings pay for it.
Oh, yeah.
So I don't know if the good guys will actually like fully win. It might just be push them back again.
Right.
Well, they know what they have to do. They know they have to kill the Night King. So I don't think it's going to be just a futile skirmish. That's going to happen. The madness of the battle to come, I can't even contemplate right now. But they know their mission has to be to kill the Night King. Like we discussed previously.
Let's speculate on who's going to kill the Night King.
Arya.
Jon.
Daenerys.
Theon.
Cersei.
No, my top two would be Theon and Arya. Like, I think Arya is who's actually going to do it, unless there's a one-on-one with Jon and the Night King.
Grey Worm. Nobody saw that coming.
Bran, the Tree Man.
Oh, boy.
It's a psychic battle.
Ooh, maybe Arya gives Bran the Valyrian steel dagger, and he just kind of like schnick.
It pokes him with it.
Yeah, snick snick.
Like forehead to forehead for the psychic battle, and he's like, "Ka-tick, nice to know you."
They have that ballista that shoots down dragons with a dragon glass, like fucking.
Like, I thought that would be the thing. Like, you bring the scorpion and put dragon glass on the end to kill the zombie dragon, and guess who fires that? Fucking Bronn. Guess who's coming?
That's right.
Oh, no. They're in dire straits. Ka-chunk.
Mm-hmm.
Got him.
I almost killed a dragon.
I'm the only man you know that shot a dragon. Now let me get in you and then get interrupted.
I'll lose my mind if Bronn dies without fucking.
All right. So I'm going to propose a theory. It's all around the internet, so it's not new to most people. There's a lot of speculation that the army that they're fighting in Winterfell is not headed by the Night King. That the Night King is taking his army to King's Landing.
Just the lieutenants are there.
Yeah, and he's on zombie dragon with maybe a few soldiers and is just going to wreck King's Landing.
Another misdirection play.
Like, surprise, no one's ready for zombies here because everyone ignored everyone else.
Just outflank them from that point?
You don't need to because no one can kill you.
Well, no, I mean, you sack King's Landing and you have a whole other, you have a 20,000 person army at that point.
Well, it's more than that because end of season 7, Jon Snow is like, how many people live there?
Ooh, yeah,
and Tyrion's like, about 1 million.
Right, right.
There's an army of 1 million sitting right there waiting.
Doesn't that creepy old maester still have like the wildfire? That could kill him, right?
If he can chuck it at a dragon.
Wasn't all the wildfire used
least the undead army that would be going there, right?
Yeah. I mean, there's still some wildfire in the Red Keep.
Anyone got a Valyrian sword in King's Landing?
Not anymore. She just sent Jaime away.
Oh. Well.
Ooh. Ooh.
And then they get outflanked in Winterfell.
Right. In King's Landing. That's what I was alluding to.
There's also the theory that it's going to end at the Trident, which is in the Riverlands. It's also where Rhaegar Targaryen died, and that's where Jon Snow will die, where his father died.
Oh. Nah, he'll sit on the Iron Throne.
Also, I want it to end with, don't care who wins for the Iron Throne. At the end of the series, they just pull back, and they're inside the eye of a blue-eyed giant. Like they say in the beginning of the series. Mugundu or something.
But that's awesome.
I want that ending.
No.
But it has to be female, and Tormund has to be sucking.
The Men in Black ending?
Yep, and, yeah, the Men in Black ending.
Jesus.
And different universe Tormund is there. I'm in. Like, I want that ending. They're actually inside the eye of a blue-eyed giant.
They're inside the eye of a giant, and then Tormund kills it. And then suckles his wife.
And we're back to where we started.
Is there anything else with this episode you guys want to touch on?
Aside from the poor timing for Jon Snow, the, hey, I'm your nephew. Like, that probably could have waited another day.
Well, and now it'll never be resolved because one of them's going to die.
She confronted him, right?
No, he confronted her. Like, she came down to the crypt and he's like, here's a whole bunch of shit.
Also, when Daenerys dies, like, does Jon now control the Unsullied army in Dothraki? What's going on there?
No.
I don't know if they do, like, inheritance.
Yeah, what's going to happen then?
She doesn't own them, so.
Right, they're free.
They're free to do whatever.
Right, except for the Dothraki horde, they're not free.
All two of them? All one of them, maybe?
Both of them are her subject.
Yeah, the stallion who mounts the world is... Right. Well, they're her blood riders, so they would do whatever Dothraki... I forgot what they do if the Khal dies.
They kill themselves?
No, they do something. I don't remember what it is.
They live in exile.
They join other Khalasar. Time to get on a boat again.
Yep. I was okay with him telling her there because, you know, when else is he going to tell her? I felt like that was after the battle.
At the tomb of Lyanna Stark.
They didn't know the battle was going to start right that second.
They said before dawn. It could have waited a day. Instead, like,
Well, no, because the whole episode was about this might be your last night on Earth.
Like, I understand why he did it in the sense of, like, plot and the sense of the show. It's just, like, I'm applying logic to a show that doesn't always apply logic. It's like, I get you want to tell her because, like, she's got the bone me eyes again. And you've been dodging her the entire day. Maybe, like, you just dumped a whole bunch of shit on the chick who controls dragons, like, your best weapon. Maybe wait and not make her consider you a threat. Those dragons are going to roast the bad guys and then turn directly on you because you're the next threat.
Right.
Will they, though? I mean, we just had that whole scene of her expressing her love for him.
Well, one dragon. Oh, and then...
Well, I mean, she does get... She, like, has to restrain herself from unleashing at him immediately. That didn't give me too much hope.
And, I mean, and there's the talk of, like, fire can't hurt a dragon, like, from the first season.
Right.
Except we've seen Jon be burned in the first season, where he took the lantern and threw it at the zombie, and it burned him, because he picked up the lantern and his hand was burned.
Right.
So, only applies to Daenerys, apparently.
Did the fire burn him, or did the lantern burn him?
It doesn't matter. Because in the first episode, Daenerys steps in, like, the boiling hot bath.
Right.
And she's fine.
Yeah.
But then also, her brother got hit with molten gold.
Right, well...
So he was a Targaryen, but he wasn't a true dragon.
Right, it might be like only females in the line get it, or...
I think it's kind of like a recessive gene, like they're the gingers of the Targaryens, you know what I mean?
Could you imagine if that...
Just the runt.
Could you imagine if that molten gold didn't kill him and he just had a fucking gold helmet, dude? Oh, he was blind?
Oh, and he would...
He was like trapped with a bag over his head the rest of his life. Oh,
good luck picking up your head because gold's fucking heavy.
Right.
So with another episode in the can.
Wait, we didn't talk about the sex scene.
Yeah, we did.
Between.
I mean, we touched on it.
How in depth do you want to go? Because first off, we didn't see a ton.
Right. It was all CGI titty.
I mean, we didn't see like any actual fucking. Like it went from making out to we're done.
It went from making out to she took her shirt off and another actress's body was there. It later, during the song, it panned to her real sad face.
The making out was
long over.
The scene in general was very...
Now kiss.
Yeah. I mean, it was a passionate scene. There was a lot of tenderness there. She really got what she wanted, though. The one line... cracked me up. I'm not the red woman, take your own damn pants off.
Oh, yeah.
That cracked me up.
There's also a theory that the red woman's going to show up at the end of the battle.
Ooh.
And win it for the good guys.
Is she going to resurrect somebody?
No, she's going to show up with a bunch of red wizards.
Oh.
Well, I have been wondering, like, I think I mentioned this before, like, where the Lord of Light
it's gonna be
matters anymore in the series, you know what I mean?
It's going to look like a cross between the Battle of Helm's Deep and, like, the final battle in Harry Potter. There's just, like, people with wands blasting shit, and then, like, there's arrows going everywhere.
I mean, Martin does take a ton from Tolkien. This is going to be very Battle of Helm's Deep.
Yeah, you think it's going to be more epic? Is it going to be more epic than Battle of Helm's Deep?
I think so.
It's going to try to be.
Right. There wasn't any fucking dragons going on.
How deep on the Lord of Light stuff do you want to go? Because I can go way deep.
Yeah, let's hear it.
So, Lord of Light, Azor Ahai. The story is he had his sword. He needed to make a sword, Lightbringer, that could kill the zombies. So, he tempered his sword in water, and it broke. So, he made another sword, and to temper it, he stabbed it in the heart of a lion, and it shattered. So, the third time, for some reason, to temper his sword, he stabbed his wife, and it didn't shatter. And when he pulled it from his wife, it was on fire. It Sick. Became Lightbringer. So the theory becomes whoever the Lord of Light chose, whoever Azor Ahai is this time, Jon Snow probably, has to kill Daenerys to make his sword Lightbringer.
But there's already the Lightbringer, right?
Yeah, what's his name, sword? That catches on fire.
It's not fire? Lightbringer. It just what catches is it? On fire.
It just catches on fire?
Yeah, it's just a fire sword.
Oh, okay.
How does that happen?
It's not the name magic.
Is it magic?
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah. He's Hold been on. Resurrected 8 times.
Well,
of course it's magic.
Okay. Religious magic.
He's chosen by a Lord of Light, so he gets a flaming sword.
Oh, yeah. So the Lightbringer is a mythical sword?
Yeah, it's like a named sword.
Oh.
And there's the theory that it's not an actual, like, specific sword. It's just a sword that can become Lightbringer.
Oh.
What can Lightbringer do? Like, what's... It's just a zombie...
It's the sword to lead us out of the Long Night. And
oh, okay.
It's just a story. Maybe he has to kill Daenerys to be able to kill the Night King. That was as shallow as I got. I can get on that.
If you guys have anything left, go for it.
I mean, little Lyanna Stark... Not Lyanna Stark. Lyanna Mormont telling... Mm-hmm. Cousin Jorah, I'm fighting. I'm a 12-year-old, but I'm fighting.
Right.
Where do you think she's going to...
She just told him off.
Where do you think the battle should be?
He was all lady.
We did get what we wanted. We got that interaction
I mean,
between the two. So it's good.
Lyanna Mormont is such a badass. She knows her station, and she just treats Jorah as such. Like, she knows she's the lady of House Mormont,
and
that's it.
I mean, I'm ready for the gut punch of Lyanna Stark. Or that did it again. Lyanna Mormont being a zombie. At some
no
point.
Way.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, she's going to win. Like no,
she's a quartiary character that is a badass. Guess who's dying?
Nah, she's not going to die. She's going to be like a hellion, just like lopping heads off.
Oh, I bet she will for 45 minutes. And yeah. Then she's going to catch one.
Well,
she
45 minutes
it.
Will be the entire battle. It's only one episode
that we know of. It could be two.
That's, yeah.
It's got to be better than the Battle of Helm's Deep, so it could be two.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, I mean, with that, Jorah could take over his house again, I guess, technically.
If they'll let him.
The way the world is now, I don't see any of these old things taking hold anymore. He has the name.
Mm-hmm. Jorah's probably dying also.
Yeah. We're saying if, right?
Yeah. I mean, if we had to pick a Mormont to die and we're picking the little girl, then I think in this new world... that is torn by zombie war. They're like, oh, you actually have the blood and the name of our lords.
Yeah.
Boom.
What happens is Jorah dies. Lyanna picks up that big ass sword and starts lopping heads off.
A sword,
dude.
That is twice her size. Yep. And in this magical Christmas land where Jorah lives and Lyanna Mormont dies. I mean, I would assume that Daenerys also like wins. So Jorah would be on the council.
I think it's one or the other. Like, I think either Jorah dies or Daenerys dies. I don't think they both die.
I think they both die.
I think Jorah's dead.
I think they both die.
Jorah's story is about over.
Like, yeah.
His
That's
arc
fine.
Is about
his,
over.
Jorah has
every,
no...
Best thing, everyone's story is four episodes from being over.
Right.
That doesn't matter.
But, well, a few of the characters' story is like ended with this episode.
Right.
Like Brienne ended with this episode. Like her dream was become a knight, basically.
Jorah has zero purpose if and when Daenerys dies.
That scene where he counsels her about Tyrion, I was just like, just give him a little something. Give him a smooch.
Well, you know? A little handy.
Who the fuck wants a hand job?
I'm pretty sure Jorah wants one, but real bad, from Daenerys.
Hey, Daenerys, you haven't checked all of me for grayscale yet.
Right. Lift the sack.
All right, so who's dying next episode?
All of them.
I actually did want to ask that. That's kind of how I wanted to end it. So
just go down the list and I'll be like, dead, lives, dead.
With another episode in the can, does your picks for first deaths change at all?
Yes, slightly. Because I picked like Beric Dondarrion.
We said like Davos and whatnot.
I think Reek like just gets destroyed in the worst way.
Who?
Reek.
He's fucking dead.
Yeah, he's gonna get blown the fuck up somehow.
He's paying the iron price again.
Yeah, like the last price he pays is that he gets turned into chunky salsa.
I thought it might be Theon too, but after hearing Ryan's theory, I think that really depends on if the Night King is at Winterfell or not, because that's Theon's whole mission, is to be and protect with Bran. So I think if the Night King's there, then yeah, Theon's fucking done.
Yeah,
you know, he's an icicle.
Yeah.
But if the Night King isn't there, I think he lives to see another day.
If that,
because he'll be away
true,
from the battle.
Like, if the Night King isn't there, I think a lot of people live, because right. we need everyone for the fight to come.
Right. A lot of people with Scottish accents go and die.
If this is the apocalyptic battle at the end, I think Brienne dies.
Like, she might die the second after she yells, hold the line. Like, a spear comes out of nowhere. Just hits her in the throat.
Or 56 zombies land on top of her. Hold the line.
Hold the line.
You know, I never thought there would be a character that I wouldn't want to die more than Daenerys or Arya, but Tormund's there, dude. Like, he's... I
mean, you want him to die?
No,
or
no,
you
no,
don't want
no,
him to
no,
die?
No, like, yeah, like, I don't want him to die. Like, Daenerys and Arya were always... And Tyrion, obviously, were, like, the three main people I never wanted to see die.
What's going to happen is, like, as soon as Brienne dies, then Tormund's going to go into a rage. And he's just going to jump right in the fray, and he's going to take out 40 zombies, but then get overrun.
Well, he was almost taken down, and then...
He's going to slay a giant zombie, too, by the way.
Every big battle we've seen always has intervention at the end. It's going bad for our heroes, mm-hmm. and then knights out of nowhere. I expect intervention in this fight of some kind. Braun with a giant crossbow, with a giant ballista, or red wizards, or Knights of the Vale that we hadn't seen already, or something.
Knights of the Vale?
I mean, we haven't seen anyone from the Vale except for the leader guy. One of Torben's titles is Husband to Bears.
Say what?
Because there's a story. I don't know if he ever told it in the show, but the story in the book. He won a fight and got super drunk one night and, like, met a pretty lady, and they went back to her place. And when he woke up in the morning, he had scratches all over himself, and he was in a bear's den. Like, and there was a mother bear next to him.
So he mounted a bear.
So, which on the surface...
So he was in Super Troopers?
...is a fun story. You go just a tiny bit deeper, and there, the place where the Mormonts live is Bear Island.
Nice.
And the lady Mormont at the time was called a she-bear.
Oh.
Which means Tormund could have mounted the she-bear of House Mormont, which is a fun thing. Like, where did Lyanna Mormont come from? Also applies to my if Lyanna Mormont dies.
Wasn't it?
And Jorah can't inherit because he got exiled.
Is she supposedly the daughter of the Lord Commander?
That's like her uncle.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Like, so it would be fun to... If we got, like, we're not going to get it, but if we got, like, a small scene where Tormund's like, you've got my eyes.
My eyes have always been blue. How about yours?
Or just, like, looks at her and goes, you look familiar. Did your mother look like you? And then have that scene go, Tormund could inherit Bear Island because there's no Mormonts to inherit it. And Jon promised the Wildlings land, put Tormund on Bear Island.
Hell yeah.
All right. Well, I think that's where we will wrap up the episode. Thank you for joining us on the second episode of our Game of Thrones series for season 8. I want to thank my guests again, David Croy.
Thanks for having me, man.
And Ryan Childs.
Thank you.
Also want to thank the band Accursed Creator for providing the music for all of Lyons Den Media podcast.
Why'd you say it weird?
Because I learned... And I said this on the last show that I've been saying their name wrong for a year and a half. That's a thing. And, you know, we're having them on.
Ooh.
Chelsea and Nate are going to... We had to reschedule because Chelsea was sick, but they're going to come on and do the Nerd Herd. So
sounds awesome.
Yeah. Look out for that. They will be coming on the show.
I hear they're good people.
Check them out on Facebook. They have a tour coming up that starts in Pensacola and kind of... goes off to a bunch of places. You can find that flyer on their Facebook page. Make sure to follow Lyons Den Media on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. Hopefully soon Instagram. And make sure to check the next episode of Real Rants where we discuss Game of Thrones Season 8, Episode 3. We're going to keep going for every episode of the new season, and eventually we will tackle the previous seasons. So make sure to follow us so you never miss an episode. Help make our roar louder.
Hear me roar.
See ya.